evening, everyone. Good evening. So we are chapter 2, part 3 of I Will Say. Still, we are going to continue on the chapter 2 next week kasi hindi tayo matatapos. But praise the Lord because we've been learning so very much about Psalm 91. And we will continue to review tonight yung fortress. Ah, tama. Fortress. And then we will study yung Elohim. Alam niyo ba yung Elohim? Sam, you know Elohim? You know the meaning of, it's the name of God, right? But do you know the meaning? Later we will know and trust. Yan. So ito yan, ano? So we've learned about Amar, I Will Say. So, last night we had a very good time fellowshipping, and really the emphasis of his voice for us is to, if you want to see something to happen in your life, you have to say it, right? Yun lang, napakasimple lang, oh, you have to say it. You have to say it into manifestation. Yan. And then Yahweh, refuge, makase, and then Matsud. What is Matsud? Diba yun yung fortress, castle? And then Elohim, and then I will trust, and then next week we will study in Him. You know that in Him doesn't have, when you click on the interlinear, wala siyang, wala. So, but I think it's going to be one of the longest, hindi naman longest. That's why I dedicated in Him for next week kasi I am anticipating that there's going to be a lot of revelation that will be revealed to us next week. But anyway, tonight, it's going to be also very good fellowshipping with one another, right? As a family and as a, and including your titas. Yan. So, Matsud, review natin. What is Matsud? Fortress, di ba? Castle. Yan, di ba? Joy is the flag that you fly in the castle of my heart, in the castle of your heart. So, your heart actually, when the Lord is your fortress, 'di ba, your heart is made your heart is fortified. Yan, it's like a castle. Yan, how long does it require to build a castle, Sam? How long? Very long time, right? And it's when you get to see a castle, it's majestic and it's fortified, it has security. So the word fortress in Hebrew comes from the root word sur. Sur. Kasi pag clinic mo tong Matsud, actually, pag clinic-click mo yan, yung original niyan, sur, which means to bind up, to press upon, to siege, to thrust forward, to advance. So diba last week, what we've studied is that what comes to your mind when you read this is the picture of David forwarding to running to Goliath. Hindi siya natakot, no? Because he knows that God is his fortress. Yan. It's also the word for a neck and a rock. So what turns the head? The neck. What turns the ship? Yung sabi ni Daddy last week.
Rudder.
The rudder, right? So in your life, in your body, yung timon, di ba? Yung timon sa Tagalog. What turns your life? What part of your body?
The tongue,
right? So what you say is important. Yan. So yung castle of your heart, it also means that, right? When you are fortified, what comes out of your mouth are things that God talks about you. Yan. So, and sinabi din natin that when you study yung tower, is that the Aramaic word for castle is actually migdel. Migdel. Yan, tower or a place of height or high honor. You are, because of Jesus Christ's finished work at the cross, you are placed in a height, very high height or high honor. It's a place of high honor for the lambs. For the Lamb who took away the sins of the world, right, placed you there. Yan, Migdel. Kasi si Lord, pinanganak doon sa Migdel Eder. This is the tower that King David has purchased, right? has purchased, and therefore it is supposed to be inherited by Joseph and Mary. And because of divine intervention and divine appointment, the Lord Jesus was born in Migdel Eder. Ayan. So among the, di ba kasi Migdel Eder, it is a place where the sacrificial lambs are raised and cared for, and then the lamb who's supposed to take away the sins of the world was born there. So si Lord, he was born here, right? What is this, Sam? This is the manger. This is the feeding trough, right? So it's very symbolic that the Lord Jesus was put there, was placed there. Meaning, you are supposed to eat the Lord Jesus. And the Lord Jesus, you're supposed to eat the Lord Jesus. Oh, di ba, nag-communion tayo kanina, di ba? So, and also the Word of God. Because the Word of God, the steady stream of His Word will strengthen you. And when times that you need saving, He will save you. Yan. So, and then we studied last week also, di ba? Ito yung picture ng fortress. So sabi ganun ni Goliath, sabi niya, I will give your flesh to the birds and the wild animals. Sabi naman ni ni David, you come against me with sword and a spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, Elohim of the armies of Israel whom you defied. Elohim, actually Elohim ba to? Hindi, Almighty Shaddai. Yeah. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I will strike you down and cut off your head. So this is a picture of David fortified. Yeah. And David having this sense of God is with him as his fortress. Yeah. So let's continue. In Psalms 139 verse 5, ang sabi nga nun ni King David, thou hast beset me behind and before and laid your hand upon me. This is so very heartwarming, no? You have beset me behind and before. You know that the word beset is also chur. You have placed me, right? As a noun. This is what Moses struck to get water from the rock. It is also used for a fortress or fortified city. The word for behind is akor, which has the idea of behind or past. The word kedem means to go forward. That word ends with a close mem, indicating the hidden or unknown as it is in the future. So this expression akor bakedem expresses past and future. Thus, in your past and in your future, God sur besets you. So the word sur is used as a verb here and is in kal perfect form. It is best expressed as you have entrenched me or fortified me in my past and in my future. You have already fortified or entrenched me. So sometimes, no, you are bogged down by your past. Kasi yung mga nakaraan ko, baka hindi na ako mabless, or yung mga ginawa ko, baka hindi na ako maka, you know, the future is not so bright for me. And then suddenly you're afraid of the future. But what the Lord is saying to us, saying to you and me, is you, the Lord has beset you from behind and from before. And He has laid His hand on you. Hallelujah. He has fortified you and entrench you. Tur, fortified. So, as David looked to the future, so there was a time in David's kingdom, in David's kingship, that the future looked pretty grim. There was unrest in the nation. Indeed, one generation later, there would be a civil war in the land. There was the threat of the Assyrians. Parang yung ngayon, ano? Diba when you click on the TV, you will see that Israel is again besetted by being bothered or molested by the neighboring countries, right? Yung mga kamag-anak ng Syrians, yung mga Iranians, diba? And there was this threat to the very throne that happened when his own son revolted, si Absalom, and sent David running from his kingdom with a price on his head. Day after day, David faced the mounting pressure of being a king and the terrors that were looking at him. So in your life, are you pressured? in work, in school, ganyan. Yet when David woke up in the morning, facing the dread of what lay ahead, he was reminded that God has fortified him. He was reminded that God has tsur him, entrench him, or another expression of tsur is hedge him. That hedge or fortress was around him in the past, and it is around him in the present, and will continue to be around him in the future. Child of God, the Lord has hedged you from before and after, from before and behind. You need not need to worry. Yan. Because he has inscribed you in the palm of his hands. You know that God has a tattoo? Yan, sabi niya eh, you know, Isaiah 49:16, your name is in the palm of his hand. Yan. So then David said, you laid your hand upon me. So the word laid, tashet, is actually in a future tense and means to a place or set. You will set me in your yapap. Yung yapap yun, yung hand, means the palm of my hand. So the verse literally says, you have set me in the palm of your hand. We are sheltered in the hollow of his hand. But remember that during those time, ancient people, the old people believed that one's heart was in the palm of the hand. So because what your heart does, your hand, what your heart believe, your hand does. Diba? Tama? Tama? Your hand is the extension of your heart. Diba pag mahal mo yung isang tao, you hug him, you embrace him, right? Because you love the person. Thus, David was saying that he will not fear or live in dread of the future, for he is sheltered in the heart of God. Child of God, lalo na yung mga young in heart here. Child of God, sons and daughters of the Most High God, you need not live in dread of the future, you are sheltered in the heart of God. Yan. It's very heartwarming, you know, and the Holy Spirit wants to emphasize this. Okay, in Genesis 1:26, Elohim, God, Elohim, you know that the meaning of Elohim, Sam, is Father, Son, and Spirit. The same Spirit who raised Jesus from the dead is in you. Father, Son, and Spirit, let us make man in our image and according to our likeness, our likeness, so that they will have dominion over all things. Because you are made in the image and likeness of Elohim, you have dominion over all things. Ah, including cockroach, yes. Including rats, yes. Including everything, including situations in your life. This was God's declaration about you, your destiny. Mankind was created as image and likeness of Father, Son, and Spirit with full dominion over all things, then placed in a finished, di ba? Yung Garden of Eden kasi finished work yun eh. And completely prepared environment and included in intimate face-to-face relationship with Elohim, Father, Son, and Spirit, in indivisible union forever with them. And then, God, Elohim, Father, Son, and Spirit saw their beautiful mankind and said, very good! When God made you, Sam, Ezra, and Gabby, he said, Tov! Good in Tov is good is Tov in Hebrew. It means functioning as designed. Ah, pag sinabi pa lang, God is good, right? It is functioning in design, and you are the exact mirror image of God, right? So you are functioning as design, completely enclosed in and surrounded with grace, beauty, love, health, and prosperity, whole and complete. So when you say good, whole and complete. Galing, no? Whole and complete. So when you say God is good, whole and complete. And because Father God, right, is my Father, I am made in the image and likeness of Him, I am whole and complete. Hallelujah. So this is what God saw. In Hebrew, it's edu, behold, with vivid emotion and declared. And it's still what God sees today over you, and He declares over you regardless of your circumstance. But from Adam's fall to the present day, sometimes we walk far, especially when we're not hearing, no? We walk far below the abundant life that God designed for us to walk in because our perception has been distorted. So I was thinking about this morning. So when you have this perception about a certain person, you react accordingly, right? So for example, when you perceive that this person doesn't like you, right? You're not close to that person. But when you know that that person, especially your parents, especially for example God, you know, from before you didn't know that he loves you very much. You thought that he was angry at you. But now as your perception is changing, you are relating to the Lord differently. Yan. Because if the perception is distorted, then also the way you will approach things is going to be different. So we have been taught to see life in ourselves through our circumstances, through other people's opinions, through our wrong understanding of who God is and how he sees us. Adam fell in his understanding of God's identity and his own identity as God's image, likeness, and design to rule and reign on earth. And mankind after him continued to fall farther and farther in that understanding. They have forgotten who they were and who God was in Deuteronomy 32:18. You forgot the rock who fathered you and forgot the God who gave birth to you. Deuteronomy says mankind was mindful and has unmindful and has forgotten. What were they unmindful of? What did they forget? Yan, ito importante. What do you forget, right? When days are bleh. Oh, we forget that we are the sons of God, made in the image and likeness of God, with dominion over all things, placed in a finished and completely prepared environment, and included in intimate face-to-face relationship with Father, Son, and Spirit, in indivisible union forever with them. The mere Bible says it this way, you have forgotten the rock that begot you and have gotten out of step with the God who danced with you. Alam niyo, panoorin niyo yung Evan Almighty sa ano, Netflix. Ang ganda. Madamang ganda, Evan Almighty. You know, natuwa ako kasi sabi ko, ay, related dun sa study namin tonight. You know that si Morgan Freeman, kasi siya yung nagganap na God eh. You know that he said, okay, let's do the dance. Diba? So God, who danced with you? Yan. So the Mechanical Translation Bible, a Hebrew translation, used the word twist or chul, which our English Bible translate gave birth. Chul means wreath, twist, whirl, or dance. The Mechanical Translation says it's a twisting together, to wrap separate pieces together, forming one unit, a wrapping or winding together or entwine. Intimate union. Yan, face to face. They were unmindful of this. So when we are not aware, right, of our union with the Lord, that's when we forget, and that's when we have this distorted perception. They forgot that they were in indivisible union with God. They saw themselves as separated from God. They were unmindful of this. They forgot they were in an indivisible union with God. They saw themselves as separated from God. Colossians 1:21 says that mankind was once alienated and hostile or adversaries in their minds. Philippians 2:15, mirror, your flawless innocence radiates attraction as beacons of light in the midst of a people who have forgotten their true sonship and whose lives have become distorted and perverse. Paano ba nagiging perverse and distorted? Because we have forgotten that we are the sons of God. But God has not forgotten. Good news. He said, I have declared the end from the beginning. Our beginning is not based on what Adam declared from the fall. It is based only on what God declared in the beginning from before creation. Yan. Now we go to ano. So ang ganda, no? Hallelujah, hallelujah. So, ito na yung trust. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge, my fortress. In Him I will trust. So the word trust in Hebrew is batak. Batak, which means to weld. So naaral natin ito before, no? But again, emphasis of the Holy Spirit. This is when you weld. Yan, si Alex marunong mag-welding. When you weld two pieces of metal together, the metal melts into each other. Tama ba, Lex? To trust God is to melt yourself into Him. Yan, betak. Archaeologists have discovered evidence of welding in the Middle East that predates this verse. Welding is securing two pieces of metal together. A perfect weld will be so secure that you could break that piece of metal in any other place before you break it at the weld. Tama ba, Lex?
Tama.
A weld will literally melt two pieces of metal into each other. Yan. So, child of God, you are welded to God. Yan. Union na naman. So, trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. Trust. Trust means weld to God. Welded to God. But batakas, another meaning. Sabi natin dati, di ba? It means also the favorite of Sam. Watermelon. What does watermelon have to do with trusting? For ancient man traveling through the desert, watermelon was a natural container to carry water as an emergency supply of water. Trusting God is when you drink from His streams of word. Yan, parang watermelon. So another picture is in trust in the Lord is this is Havdalah. The Havdalah candle. So, tingnan niyo yung picture. Lex, sino may picture? Which is common, it is a common Jewish wedding gift. Yan. Yan, no? Parang tirintas. It is two rope-like candle braided together. As they burn, the wax melts into each other, becoming one. It is a symbol of marriage where two gradually grow into each other until they become one. Yan. So, the word in Hebrew, anong ibig sabihin ng welded? You are married to God, di ba? You're married to God. The word in Hebrew for bridegroom is katan, which is also the word for marriage. Again, the word for Hebrew for bridegroom is katan, which is also the word for marriage. In its Semitic root, it has the idea of being joined together in complete truth and honesty. So as a bridegroom rejoices over his bride, so will your God rejoice over you. Because you are married to Him who was raised from the dead, grace is not a gift, not a gift God gives you so you can continue living by yourself. Because the word bride is kala, which has a double meaning, destruction and completion. When you are married to God as a bride to a bridegroom, your old life is destroyed. No longer is it a life devoted to just yourself, but you live to bring pleasure to another person. So too, in our marriage to God, we live to receive from Him pleasure, married to Him who was raised from the dead. Said, and then another picture, ito, hindi to mag-asawa. This is the father and bride dance. Yan. Sino ba ang bida sa wedding? Sino ang bida? Yung bride ba o yung groom? The bride, correct. Some translation says, there's a verse in the Bible, rejoice always, and again I say, and say rejoice. Yan. Yung rejoice doon, rejoice always rejoice or rejoice at all times. There is one word in this verse, the word is kaba, which is not always translated. Kaba is the word be, which is in imperative form as a command. We are always to be in the state of joy. The word for joy is kadin, which is an active participle. It is something we are continually to be doing. In the Greek, the word rejoice is kairet, which is simply means to be glad. However, Paul's spoken language is Aramaic, and the word used in the Aramaic Bible is much more expressive of the type of joy he's talking about. It is the word kada, which does not mean a bridal dance, but the joy of the bridal dance. Yan, kanina di ba connect? The Lord who dances with you. You never hear of a groom dance. Remember in the prodigal son's story, di ba? There is singing and dancing. So si Lord, he's a dancer, right? In ancient times, the bride was the center of attraction. The ancients even had a word for the joy of this dance, kada. This is the joy that the apostle is declaring we should have. This is the joy of our salvation, our wedding or marriage to God, which will be a marriage for all eternity. God wants to show us off is so proud of us and we rejoice or kada over our groom, Jesus Christ. Yan. So, now which leads to us to the ano, to the story of the Samaritan woman. Do you know the story? The woman at the well? Sabi gano'n ni Lord Jesus sa kanya, go get your husband. And then sabi niya, I have no husband. She replied, you have well said, I have no husband. For you have had 5 husbands, and the man you are with is not your husband. So pag tinignan mo to, pag binasa mo lang to, parang it looks like she is very promiscuous and parang it looks like a prostitute. But actually, the scripture doesn't say that she's a prostitute. Ah. It doesn't say. A little cultural backstory here. Jesus, kasi we're talking about well dead, we're talking about marriage, we're talking about our union with the Lord. Right? Jesus had just turned this discussion with this woman to a very powerful spiritual matter concerning living waters. Culturally, a Samaritan woman was not allowed to discuss spiritual things with a man other than her husband, which is why Jesus told her to get her husband. Ah, kaya pala sinabi ni Lord na go get her husband kasi they are not allowed to talk about spiritual stuff. Yan. Secondly, a Samaritan woman had to be under the domain of a man, otherwise she was considered a prostitute. So clearly, hindi siya prostitute because she was under the domain of a man. Hence, there was a lot of horse trading going on among men with their wives, or should we say, wife trading. A man had no choice but to take an unmarried woman into his home if she did not have a husband, especially when magkapatid yun eh, especially kung magkapatid. So, after a while, if the man got tired of the woman, he would have to find another man willing to take off his hands. That might make it a little rough if the poor woman had some disability or was not, not a hot number, ganyan. Sometimes a husband would have to throw in an ox or a donkey in as a part of the deal to take the wife off his hands. Such a husband who enters a marriage of convenience is often very unloving. So more or less, no, kita natin yung nangyari doon sa Samaritan woman. Mukhang ganito yung nangyari sa kanya. Pinagpasapasahan. And this man are actually very unloving and in fact treats the wife as a slave who could beat her up, torment the wife emotionally, and get away with it. Samaria was truly a man's world. Such a husband was called in the Aramaic a Baal. Yon. A Baal. Baal, an evil or abusive husband. That is exactly the Aramaic word that the Lord Jesus used when he told that woman to get her husband. That is her Baal, her abusive husband. She responded by saying, oh, I do not have a Baal. I don't have an abusive husband. Jesus said she was right because the man she was married to, because culturally she had to be married, was not a Baal. He was in fact an Ishi. Ishi. Ang husband pala no, sa Aramaic is Ishi. Lex, you are my Ishi. Ishi. You're my Uishi. Yeah. A loving, caring husband who respected her and was good to her. Yan. So ito yung sa Netflix, doing sa The Chosen. The point is, after being passed around by 5 different men, she landed on her feet with a good man, with an Ishi. A loving, caring, tender-hearted man who really loved her. Her dream to have someone who really cared for her and was not abusive. How often must she have prayed to God for a caring man in her life? How often she felt that if she had such a husband, an Ishi, she would be satisfied. But she wasn't, right? Because ano siya, pinag-uusapan siya dun sa town eh. Kahit na meron na siyang Ishi, kasi nga of her past, di ba? She's being minamarites siya, right? So the kindness and the goodness of our Lord Jesus, you know that he wasn't supposed to go to Samaria kasi malayo yun eh. Nag-detour siya just to go and meet with the Samaritan woman. Right? The Lord heard her cry. Yun lang eh. Yun lang yung makikita mo dito eh. Jesus knew something. He knew her heart and knew even though she got what she wanted and she was the envy of many other Samaritan women, kaya siya pinagchichismasan, she was not satisfied. She still had an emptiness or a longing in her heart. Jesus told her that longing could not be satisfied with a perfect husband. For what she craved, her husband, no man. Waters. Diba sabi ni Lord, if you know the person, right, who is standing in front of you, that he can give you living waters, you will not thirst anymore, right? So ang ending nga nun, diba, the Lord opened her eyes and she came to know the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So child of God, you and I, right, you and I, God has pursued for a long time. God has found us, and He's saying to us in Hosea 2, verse 19, I will betroth you unto me for how long? Sam, how long? I will betroth you forever. Yea, I will betroth you. Inulit na naman. I will betroth you unto me in righteousness and in judgment and in loving kindness and in mercies. Ano ba yung betroth? What is betrothal? Di ba? Aras yan, di ba? The word in Hebrew is aras. The word itself, aras, tama ka, Dex, come from a Semitic root found in Sumerian language, which means to desire. Hence, the whole idea behind a betrothal is to build a desire between a man and a woman. There was an ancient teaching that when a male child is born, his ancient teaching to, not necessarily among the Talmud, ganyan, was split into two, and the other half of his soul would be placed by God into a female child who would be one day be born. God would anoint the shidduch or matchmaker who would have a prophetic gift to determine the young woman who had other half of the soul of the male. Hence the term soulmates. Doon pala nagaling yun. Often this determination was made between two individuals who had never met each other. It was understood that there must be a period of time for these two to learn to love each other before the marriage was consummated. Thus, we have the time of betrothal. This is where the idea of engagement originated. This whole idea of engagement and engagement ring has its roots in Judaism. So engagement yun. Diba inaral natin dun ito sa Eat Your Way to Life and Health? This is a Jewish concept as God is giving us a picture of our relationship to Him. In Hosea, so we are betrothed to Him forever. Betrothed, forever. Honeymoon, yan. So Hosea 2:14-23, therefore behold, I will allure you, that's you. I will allure her, that's you. And bring her into wilderness. Actually, when you study this, this is pasture. And speak. So when the Lord speaks to you, He's not angry at you. The Lord speaks comfortably, intimately to you. And I will give her vineyards from hence. And the valley of Achor for a door of hope. The valley of trouble will be turned into a valley of hope, confident expectation of good, because the Lord is with you. And you shall sing, answer there, as in the days of your youth, pure and without spot or blemish, as in the days when she came out of the land of Egypt. Egypt means siege, enclosure, or bondage of work. The finished work of Jesus Christ freed us from this estate. And it shall be at that day, says the Lord, rather Yahweh, our Father God, thou shalt call me Ishi. You shall call me your bridegroom. Ishi, man in the flesh. And you shall come, call me no more Baali. Ang ibig palang sabihin ng Baal, no? Abusive. Baali means abusive. It means an idol with whom you cannot have any relationship. For I will take away the names of Baalim, useless idols, out of her mouth, the ones she worships, and they shall no more be remembered by their name. And in that day I will make a covenant for them with the beast of the field and with the fowls of the heaven and with the creeping things of the ground. Nothing will ever hurt you again. Death is overcome. And I will break the bow and the sword and the battle out of the earth. No more death, sorrow, pain, and hardship forever. And I'll make them to lie down safely in His glorious rest. And I will betroth you unto me forever. Yea, I will betroth you unto me in righteousness, in judgment, in loving kindness, and mercies. And I will betroth you even to me in faithfulness. New faith, trust in His name. And you shall know, you shall know, right? And have intimacy with the Lord your God. And it shall come to pass in that day I will hear, respond, says the Lord. I will hear the heavens, and they shall hear the earth. Heaven and earth shall kiss, and the earth shall hear the corn and the wine and the oil. Ito na, it has come to pass, kasi the cross is already finished, diba? So now when we are taking communion, we are being reminded, right? We're being reminded about the fullness of the Godhead that is in us, right? And they shall hear Jezreel. Ano yung Jezreel? Yahweh sowed himself in human flesh. And I will sow her into me in the earth. It's the story of the Lord. And I will have mercy, deep love, and compassion upon her that has not obtained mercy, accused of being a sinner. And I will say to them which are not my people, I will say to them which were not my people, thou art my people. And they shall say, you are my God. You are Elohim, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So, my dear family and friends, Hosea 2:19, the Lord is saying to you, you are betrothed forever. Yea, you are betrothed unto righteousness, unto judgment, and loving kindness. And therefore, you can say, I will say of the Lord, you are my refuge, my God, my fortress. In Him, I will trust. And that, my dear friends and family, is chapter 2, part 3. Praise the Lord.